Hello, I am Antoine from ODEON, and I'm very glad to participate in this e-forum. Today, I will talk about sine sweep optimization for room impulse response measurements. The acoustic conditions of rooms are characterized by a set of frequency-dependent room acoustic parameters, which are defined in the ISO 3382 standard. These room acoustic parameters can be derived from the measurement of impulse responses between sources and receivers in the room. Numerous methods have been developed to enhance impulse response measurements, but one that has proven particularly robust is the sine sweep method. In this method, a sweep is played by the source and it is recorded by the receiver. The recorded signal is then deconvolved to obtain the impulse response. An important aspect of the measurements is the signal-to-noise ratio, or SNR, as the room acoustic parameters require sufficient SNR in all octave bands to be properly estimated. With sine sweep measurements, the SNR can be improved by increasing the volume of the source, but it is also possible to increase the duration of the sweep. This second solution can be advantageous to ensure that the drivers of the source are not damaged by too high levels. However, the SNR measured at the receiver position can still vary. Some of the factors affecting it are the response of the source, the receiver, the room, and the presence of background noise. Therefore, the objective of this study is to optimize the sweep spectrum in order to compensate for SNR differences across bands. With this corrected sweep, the goal is to obtain a flat SNR across bands in the measurements. So the overall idea is to first evaluate the SNR per octave band, then to modify the sweep spectrum accordingly, and finally to perform the impulse response measurement with the corrected sweep. In the rest of the presentation, I will go through some aspects of the methodology and present experimental results to validate the approach. Moving on to the methodology, the sine sweep technique and the optimization feature are available in the software ODEON 16. I will quickly cover some aspects of the sweep's design and present how the sweep spectrum can be corrected, either manually or using a previous measurement. In ODEON, sweep signals are generated in the frequency domain. The spectrum has an exponential form, which is represented as a straight line in the graph on the right. We generally use pink sweeps, which have a slope of minus 3 decibels per octave, because they provide the same amount of energy in every octave band. The sweep is defined on a given frequency range, and its spectrum is bandpassed accordingly, as you can see on the graph. We design the sweep with an almost constant amplitude, which means that the power spectrum is conveyed by varying the sweep's speed in the time domain. In ODEON, the user can manually enter a set of corrections per octave band, which we call LI. The LI values compare the power in the initial sweep, pi 0, and the corrected sweep, pi, in decibels. The graph on the right shows the distribution of the LI for an example. We assume that the corrections correspond to a redistribution of the total power of the sweep. To satisfy this assumption, the corrections LI must be offset by a number delta, which depends on the initial power distribution in the sweep and the LI themselves. After the offset, the power corrections have the same variations, but they are centered on zero, as shown on the graph. Additional constraints are also applied to the corrections. Firstly, the power in one octave band should remain smaller than the total power. In addition, we impose a minimum time spent per octave band by the sweep, which also leads to constraints in terms of power. The corrections may be truncated to fulfill these constraints. Once the power corrections are properly defined, we calculate the magnitude spectrum of the corrected sweep. This is done by defining a correction function LF, which is a continuous function of frequency in decibels. LF is calculated by interpolation. You can read more about the interpolation procedure in the paper, but you can see on the graph that it is based on imposing values at the center frequencies of the octave bands, as well as on the frequency limits of the bands. The resulting corrected sweep spectrum is shown in this next graph, where you can see that the sweep is only modified on the sweep's frequency range. The correction consists of oscillations around the initial spectrum in order to preserve its total power. So far, we have seen how to handle manual corrections of the sweep. Another new feature of ODEON 16 is to correct the sweep spectrum automatically from a previous pilot measurement. This automatic correction aims at equalizing the measured SNR across bands, so we first need a measure to represent the SNR. It has been chosen to use the decay range, which is the dynamic range of the Schroeder decay curve. Indeed, the decay range is automatically calculated per octave band in ODEON from impulse response measurements. Furthermore, it is related to the SNR, as larger SNRs will lead to longer decay curves. Finally, the shrouded decay curves are directly used to derive the reverberation times, which are some of the desired room acoustic parameters. It is thus relevant to use decay curves to assess the quality of measurements. With a measure for the SNR, we have all the elements to carry out an automatic correction of the sweep. Let's go through the different steps with an example. We start with an initial pilot sweep with a pink spectrum. We make a first impulse response measurement with this sweep, from which we obtain the decay range per octave band. An initial set of spectrum corrections is found as the negative of the decay ranges. Then, the corrections are offset and truncated if needed, as explained for manual corrections. In the example, you can see that the correction is now centered around zero and that it is truncated at 125 Hz. Next, the full spectrum correction is obtained by interpolation. Finally, the sweep spectrum is calculated and the sweep is generated in the time domain. The new sweep sounds like this. You can hear that the lowest frequency bands are strongly attenuated, which leaves more time for the three highest frequency bands. The measurement is then repeated with the corrected sweep. An important aspect of the method is that the initial pilot measurement and the corrected measurement must be performed in the same experimental conditions. The automatic correction method was tested by measuring the impulse response of the room with fixed source and receiver positions. The goal of this experiment was to check if the corrected sweeps led to a flatter decay range across frequencies. The pilot sweeps were designed from 125 Hz to 4 kHz with a pink spectrum and a duration of 8 seconds. We cover several cases in the paper, but I will focus on one example in which a Hoover was operating in the room. This first graph shows the background noise level, LEQ in orange, measured with a sound level meter at the receiver position. For comparison, we also show the ambient conditions in blue where the Hoover is turned off. The Hoover leads to a higher background noise level than in ambient conditions, with values from 47 decibels at 125 Hz and a 60 decibel peak at 1 kHz. We measure two pilot impulse responses with the Hoover on, and this next graph shows the measured decay range per octave band for these pilots. A first observation is that up to 2 kHz, the decay range agrees well with the measured background noise, where higher noise floors lead to lower decay ranges. At 4 kHz, the decay range decreases, which is probably due to a lower output power of the source in this band. In addition, the decay range estimation is overall repeatable, although we see occasional differences between the two pilot measurements up to 3 dB, for instance at 2 kHz. You should also note the wide range of values from 23 decibels to 47 decibels. Each pilot results in a set of automatic spectrum corrections displayed in the following table. The two pilots end up with similar corrections, again with differences up to 3 decibels between them. The corrections reduce the lower frequency bands considerably in order to boost the three higher octave bands. It should be noted that for pilot 1, the correction of minus 20 decibels at 125 Hz actually violates the minimum time constraints for sweeps of 8 seconds. Therefore, it is truncated to minus 17 decibels in practice. This graph shows the resulting decay ranges for three corrected sweep measurements from the first pilot. The blue dashed line shows the decay ranges measured for the pilot. The corrected measurements lead to a flatter decay range at higher frequencies, around 26 decibels. You can also see that the decay range has effectively been increased in the three highest octave bands. At lower frequencies, the decay range has been reduced, but not as much as expected. It is still too high at 125 Hz and 250 Hz, and it drops too low at 500 Hz. The first issue is that the background noise may vary during the measurement. In that case, the corrections no longer correspond to the measurement conditions. Secondly, the decay range is more difficult to estimate at low frequencies, partly because of octave filtering artifacts. And that is especially visible at 125 Hz, where the three corrections lead to different decay ranges. Moreover, as mentioned earlier, the correction was truncated at 125 Hz, so we cannot expect this octave band to be sufficiently attenuated. Finally, it is possible that the design of the correction fails for such large differences of decay range between bands. A way to measure the flatness of the decay range over the octave bands is to calculate a simple standard deviation over the bands. The table on the right shows the standard deviations for the pilot and for the corrections. Overall, the three corrections lead to a reduction in standard deviation compared with the pilot, which shows that the method is still relatively successful. As an application, we can study how the correction affects the derivation of reverberation times, for instance, T20. In ODEON, the background noise level is subtracted from the decay curve, which makes it possible to estimate reverberation time parameters with lower decay ranges than recommended in the ISO standard. In that regard, a decay range of 25 dB is enough to derive T20 instead of 35 dB in ISO 3382. Let's look at this table comparing a pilot and a corrected measurement. The pilot decay range is below 25 decibels at 1 kHz, 2 kHz, and 4 kHz, so T20 cannot be derived in these bands. After the correction, the decay range in these three bands is increased to about 27 decibels, so it is now possible to calculate T20 there. At 125 Hz and 250 Hz, the correction leads to a considerable decrease in decay range, but it is still sufficient to properly estimate T20. However, the correction was made at the expense of a large drop at 500 Hz, where the decay range is now below 25 decibels. We still have an improvement in the corrections, where T20 is estimated in 5 out of 6 bands instead of 3 out of 6 bands for the pilot. In conclusion, we have presented a method to optimize the sweep spectrum and to compensate for SNR variations across octave bands. The method is based on a pilot impulse response measurement to estimate the SNR distribution using the decay range. Experimental results have shown that the correction leads to a flat and repeatable decay range above 1 kHz. The method greatly depends on the accuracy of the estimated decay range, which is more sensitive at low frequencies. The method aims at obtaining a constant SNR across octave bands, in which case the room acoustic parameters are calculated in the same conditions for all bands. However, the presented method only redistributes energy, and it might still be needed to use longer sweeps to achieve a sufficient decay range across the whole spectrum. And this concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.